Looking at setting up our egg boxes. I know I've done this video before, but I keep getting asked time and time again, so I thought, to hell with it, let's do another video. So let's check out how I do my egg boxes. Let's have a look. So let's look at the egg box in a bit more detail. I've done this video before, but I keep getting asked questions, so I thought, let's do it again, as it may help refresh people's memory. Now, egg boxes, to me, there's a lot of people out there who overcomplicate it. And I understand why to a certain degree, because these are our precious eggs. We want to make sure we get some fantastic results. Too many people overcomplicate it. And you want to make it so you can put the eggs in the incubator and not worry about it. Now, obviously I have done an incubator build, and you guys know I use old drink coolers to incubate my eggs because I find it works very, very well. I've had great success, and if it ain't broke, don't fix it, facts. So sometimes it will depend on your incubator, on how you set up. But if you're using a drinks cooler to incubate your eggs, this method I've used for years. I've got other breeders using this method after their previous method failed or was failing. They swapped over and tried mine, and they had some fantastic results. So let's look at the tub first in detail. So these are the Wham 9-litre shoe boxes. They come in packs of three, so you buy them in threes, and I find they work fantastic. And the reason being is because the really useful tubs don't actually seal around the rim. They have quite a bit of air gap, which is okay to a certain degree, but the idea with our incubator tubs is to keep in as much humidity as possible. But what we don't want is we don't want it to be stagnant humidity, and I'll go over that. So these Wham 9-litre shoe boxes, you can find them on the internet. Just put in Google Wham 9-litre shoe boxes and you'll find them. Okay, I'll try and leave a link in the description box below, but most supermarkets sell these. Anyway, let's look at the grid system that I use. This is plastic grid. It comes in, I think it comes in a meter by meter square. You can buy these from any fish pond center. It comes in a big grid, and what you'd normally do is you'd put this at the base of your pond with your filter on top. A lot of people in the States and Canada, they use light diffuser grid plastic stuff. This is the same sort of stuff. It's just, it's easier to get it this way. If you go to a fish pond place, ask them for the grid that the filter sits on, and you'll tend to get something like this. Obviously you cut it up to your size of your tub so it fits in perfect. It works. I still use these when the eggs are stuck together. The other things I use are the hatch trays, which there's two floating around in the UK at the moment. One is Herp Exotic hatch trays, and you've got the Easy Hatch tray as well, which is also floating around. I have Herp Exotic and I have the Easy Hatch tray. And as if by magic, I also have a new style of hatch tray. Now this is from Dragon Hatch, okay, which is made here in the UK, or, well, yeah, in the UK, in Wales. Hopefully you guys can see that. The home of the dragons. And I love this system probably a bit more because, you know, when you get those weird shape ball python eggs and they sort of a bit more oblong, well, with this, as you can see, you can actually fit, it still fits 10, but you can actually fit them on without them being sort of, if you look at these, it allows for bigger eggs, and also allows for them to be laid at an angle which will allow them to fit in. So you can see these fit slightly bigger eggs. I've currently got a clutch of eggs on one of these at the moment, which I'll grab in a moment and I'll show you. So I've tried and tested it first, and then I ordered some and I like them. Now, if this is one thing I want to speak to you guys as well, there's a lot of breeders out there who will peel the eggs apart. So when a female lays a clutch, they'll peel the eggs apart and they'll sit them on the hatch trays, or they'll put them down individually. It's fine. It doesn't matter if you want to pull them apart or leave them together. My motto is, how they lay is how they stay. If the clutch of eggs are loose, then I will use something like a hatch tray. If they are stuck together, I will use a grid. The reason why I don't pull them apart is because when you pull them apart, they rip. And you can get around that pretty easy by using a Billy over at Mutation Creation, and Austin and the guys over there, they use pieces of tape, like scotch tape. They put it over the rip, it goes for incubation fine, and it hatches out all okay. For me, I'd rather not pull them apart. That's just me, okay? Doesn't mean my way's right, doesn't mean the pulling them apart is wrong. That's just how I see it. I'd just rather leave them as they were laid. So how they lay is how they stay. So you've got a couple of variations. As you can see, you can obviously cut this to whatever size you want and it will fit in there perfect. And again, the hatch trays fit these 9-litre tubs very comfortably. So these can go in there. And again, the new ones from Dragon Hatch will also go in there easy, okay? Let's look at the substrate I use. So I use vermiculite. You can use perlite, you can use just water. The choice is yours. This is how I do it, and this is what works for me. So first thing I do, I get my tub, I get a soldering iron. Hopefully you guys can see. I put a little hole just above halfway, okay? There's little mold marks here. I normally put one hole there and one hole at the back, so it has air going through, okay? And I'll tell you the reason why. As I said earlier, we want the humidity to stay in there, but we want to get rid of any stagnant air. So if you can imagine now, your incubator has got a fan on and it's circulating the air in the incubator. What it will do as well, because you've got an in and an out hole, or an exhaust and an inlet hole, basically only one item can occupy a space. So the stagnant air in here will get sucked out of one of these holes, and in its place will come fresh air. What does that mean? That means I haven't got to use a press and seal type or cling film or a press and seal type system where every week I've got to go in, I've got to open the press and seal, let the air go in, you know, put it back down, put it back in, and put it back in the incubator. Pretty much when the eggs go in here, because how the system works, it goes in, I don't have to touch it, I don't normally touch it until about a week or two before they're due to hatch. And what I do a week or two before they're due to hatch, I just lift the top. Obviously, any water will run off and go into the tub, but I just make sure that the eggs are all okay. Put the lid back on and just leave it and just put it back. Up until a week or two before they're due to hatch, I do not need to worry or go in and mess with the tubs. And the reason for this is because what we're trying to do is keep a constant heat within the tub. If you're going in every week, lifting the tub, undoing the press and seal, undoing the cling film, letting the fresh air in, putting it back on, putting it back, something could happen. I'm not saying it will, but it could. So for me, it's all about making it easy, making it simple, and the less I interfere at the early stage of the incubation, the better. So let's look at the vermiculite. The vermiculite, I don't need to measure, you know, one part vermiculite to 10 parts water, or you know, one part vermiculite to one part water. I don't have to do that. The vermiculite is there to hold the water and stop it from splashing around and onto the eggs. So it's a base. It's a base fact. So the water does not matter if the water, like at the moment, if I do this, you can see all the water coming down. Okay? All right? If I lay down flat, that water evenly distributes along the bottom. It's not going to interfere with the eggs. It's a bit wet because I've just washed this down. It's not going to touch the eggs, and the water, there's enough humidity in there to see the whole incubation period and then some. Because believe it or not, I'm all about sort of waste and trying to recycle waste. So I do not get rid of my vermiculite after one hatching season. I just put it back in the incubator, and when it's ready to have fresh eggs put in, I water it down. You can see this is wet. I water it down, hose it down, so it's got a bit more water in there. Wash off any vermiculite from around the side where the snakes have been crawling, and that's good to go. That's done again. So that's ready for this season. You know, it's all about conserving waste, energy, all that sort of stuff. So if I can do a little bit here and there to, yeah. I'm not going to save the planet, but you get what I'm saying. I don't recycle my vermiculite. I use it year in, year out. I don't have a problem. I know plenty of breeders that do it that way. It doesn't create an issue. Like I said, you can use perlite. You can use vermiculite. You can use, a lot of people use sponges, and then they put the egg tray. They tend to use these egg trays and put them on top. But again, that's a different method. And we're talking about my method today, and why I do it this way and why it's so successful. Again, it's idiot proof, it's easy to do, and it's not complicated. You need to put these air holes in, okay, with a little soldering iron, just so the air can pass through. The lid clicks down either end, okay, but it's not airtight, okay? So that's kind of important, because we don't want, in my eyes, we don't want to seal it in, but we want to keep the humidity in as much as possible. The really useful tubs, they have gaps along the sides which allow the condensation or allow the humidity to leave the tub, which will end up drying up your eggs, and you'd have issues where you're going to have to keep putting more water in to try and rehydrate the dried up eggs. So doing it this way is idiot proof. I find it works really well, and I've used it for years. I've converted other breeders onto it because they find that it worked a lot easier than their method, and they were having probably less success with their clutches. So doing it this way, like I said, it really does work. It's easy, simple, and there you have it. Normally my incubator runs at about 91 degrees Fahrenheit, which means within the incubator it runs at 90. Within the egg box it runs at about 88 to 89 degrees Fahrenheit. Normally my hatchlings hatch around about day 53 to day 55. Again, incubation temperatures is each their own. You've got to collect the data. For me, it's all about collecting data and proving what works and what doesn't work. I haven't just gone out there and just gone, oh well, I'm going to put my stat up to 91 and cook all my eggs. No, I monitor it. I take the data that I collect very seriously, because it's all a learning curve, and if there is an issue, I need to know why there's an issue. So data will help provide that information. So it's in, most people put their stats on about 89, which means within the incubator it's about 88, and within the tub itself it ends up being about 86 to 87 degrees Fahrenheit. Like I said, for me, I run it slightly warmer, again, because I incubate this way, I can. Those are my incubation temps. You've obviously seen, I've done videos on incubators, on how to build one for yourself. This is obviously just another follow-up video regarding egg boxes and getting your egg boxes ready. And let me stress, you fail to prepare, prepare to fail. If you do not have these egg boxes ready, trust me, you'll wake up one morning, your female will be on a clutch of eggs, and all hell will break loose because you won't know what to do. Get these bad boys done, get them in the incubator, ready to go. So if you do have a surprise clutch, you haven't got to panic. You can just go ahead, take her off the eggs and put the eggs in your egg box, and they go in the egg, in the incubator. Job done. Okay. So again, guys, if you wouldn't mind just hitting that notification bell, smashing that like button, and obviously hitting that subscribe button. If you do have any questions, please put them down in the comment boxes below. I love reading all your comments. I love the interaction and I love your guys' feedback. Again, there's multiple ways to do this. This is my way. This is what works for me. I've done it for years. And again, time and time again, it just works. All right, guys. But for now, I'll leave that with you. Take care. Hopefully you're all well. Love and respect you all. Take care. And I'll see you guys in the next one. I hit record it, drop, you can't ignore it. I'm transforming.